टेस्ट व्हेन इट रीचेस टू वीजीएस माइनस वीटीएच पॉइंट, जिसको हम लोग ओवरड्राइव आल्सो वी से इट. फाइन, सो दिस इज अ पिंच ऑफ पॉइंट. सो एट द पिंच ऑफ पॉइंट द करंट विल ट्राई टू रीच, दैट विल बी द मैक्सिमम वैल्यू. व्हाट हैपेंस आफ्टर पिंच ऑफ? After pinch off, if further VDS is increased, this pinch off point will move to left hand side towards the source. So towards the source, like say this is the shifting, but then also there will be some small amount of current will be flowing, and we say here the current becomes almost constant after the pinch off point. A very less jumping of high due to high electric field, the electron jumps, and very small change in the current happens, and ID remains almost constant. And we say that here, since ID becomes a constant current and it is not changing with the VDS voltage, we say it is a current source which is independent of output voltage. Okay, this is your output current and this is your output voltage, the x-axis. So current becomes independent of the output voltage. So what does it behave like? If you recall your independent source, the resemblance, the symbol is this one, and let's say if 3 ampere is there. Okay, so what will be the voltage drop across this? If there any voltage changes there or not, but the current will always retain constant, that is up to 3 ampere. So it behaves like a constant current source, we say. And we get the graph of like this one. Then we have seen the IV characteristic, and the same relation we followed, that I equals to Q dV, and the total charge in the area was given by WCX VGS minus VTH. Then at any point X, if you want to compute the current, then what is the total inversion charge? It will be minus VGS minus VX minus VTH, and then putting this QD into the I equation, and where V is was your drift velocity, and it is given by mu into E, and E is minus dV by dx. Substituting all the values, we got the IV relation in this form. Okay, so this was my IV relation. From here we deduce that what should be the condition when VDS is less than VGS minus VTH, when VDS is equals to VGS minus VTH, and when VDS is greater than VGS minus VTH. So this graph was resembling like a parabola, and then we taken the first derivative and we calculated what should be the maximum value, and the maximum value came at VGS minus VTH value. So we said that this at this point, whatever current will be attained, that will be the maximum current, and based on that, so this region, the left half region, was declared as a triode region because it was changing with change in the voltage. But after this VGS minus VTH point, change in voltage was not affecting the current, so we chose that it is a saturation region. So right half became the saturation, left half became the your triode region. And where is the cutoff? Cutoff is the point when VDS is zero. So this is the cutoff region. In the cutoff region, what will happen? What will be the current? Current will be zero. So this x-axis is nothing but your cutoff region. So three regions we got here. And then this is the same thing is here. Then MOS IV characteristic, we seen when VDS is very, very less than VGS minus VTH, then we got the relation of ID in this form. So looking at this expression, we can say here is the output current, it is the output voltage. So taking the ratio of output current to output voltage, that is VDS by ID, we got the value of RDS. This is nothing but RDS, which is equals to 1 by mu n Cox W by L VGS minus VTH. So what does it shows? It shows that when a MOSFET will operate into the triode region or into the deep triode region, it will behave like a resistor whose value will be given by this parameter, which will be depending upon your process factor, that is mu n Cox, and it will depend upon only on the input voltage, that is inversely proportional to the input voltage VGS. And this is also known as on resistance because the MOSFET is in the conducting state, so we call it as a on resistance. So if suppose this is the MOSFET resembling, and I say it is operating in linear, so this can be modeled like a resistor, where it is a variable resistor and whose value is a function of VGS. Changing the value of VGS, I can modulate the current value, sorry, modulate the resistance value. So this was your IV. Then comes what will be the pinch off behavior. Pinch off behavior here means this is also called pinch off region, and when further VDS is increased, this pinch off point is moved towards the source, and then again this is also called pinch off. So what is the difference between the two figure? The difference is initially the complete length was L. Now further increase in VDS, the pinch off moved towards the source, so definitely my L is also reduced. So that time, let's say L is L dash. Initially it was L, now it is L dash. So when I will write equation for this one, ID for this graph, if I write ID expression, and since it is in saturation because it has reached the pinch off point, means where VDS is equals to VGS minus VTS. So I will write here half mu n Cox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square. When I will write the equation for this one, what the change will come here? The change will come in terms of L. Now this L will be represented by L dash. So it will be half mu n Cox W by L dash VGS minus VTH. So this is the ID expression. Now when we do the calculations or when we do the analysis, we are not aware of this, what will be the L dash, because it can be at any point between the length of source and drain. It can be at any place. Where can be the exact pinch off position, we cannot predict. So this means this L dash is nothing but a hypothetical or a variable quantity. So we need to get the expression in terms of all the physical constant parameters given by the manufacturer. This means I have to evaluate this L dash in terms of standard parameters. So how to do? So this L dash, what is this L dash? This L dash is nothing but complete length is L, and what is the deviation is by delta L. So I can say L dash is L minus delta L. Fine. And what will be the voltage? Voltage will be, let's say, VD set. Initially it was VDS, that was equals to VGS minus VTH. Now after this, the saturation is reached. This means any voltage greater than this VDS will be called as VD sat. VD sat means VD saturation voltage. So let's say at L dash point, whatever the voltage is here, VD saturation voltage. So now this was the equation. Now in this equation, L dash I will replace by, here I will write here half mu n Cox W by L dash will be L minus delta L VGS minus VTH whole square. Right. Further, half mu n Cox W by L. Let us divide this W by L. So what will happen? On the top also L will come, and this will be L minus delta L. Let's make the animation transition. So this will be L minus delta L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So what will happen? This L, if you take in the denominator, what will happen? It will become, this particular parameter will become 1 by 1 minus delta L by L. Fine. So what we got the expression? This is the additional factor that is coming here, and half mu n Cox W by L VGS minus VT naught whole square. So this expression is nothing but your standard ID expression when the pinch off was reached at the L position. So further, this L dash, why it came? It came because of VDS, because of change in VDS. So I can say that whatever deviation, the normalized value, that delta L change in the length by L, I can say it is a function of VDS. So I can replace by a lambda VDS, where lambda is called your channel length modulation factor. Okay, and generally the value of lambda is less than 1. So since lambda is less than 1, I can say lambda VDS will be always less than 1. Now substitute this L dash delta L by L dash in this expression. If this is substituted here, so what we'll get here? This half meters, this is the standard ID what we have got. And in addition to that, what will we get here? Let me erase this part. Okay. One minute, we have to write. Okay, here I will write on the top. So what will happen here? This factor, if I take in the top, it will be 1 minus delta L by L is lambda VDS. So 1 minus lambda VDS to the power minus 1. Now it is the expansion of 1 plus x to the power minus 1. So if we expand, what we'll get here? 1 plus lambda VDS, and then again plus what the factor will come into the square form. So since lambda VDS is less than 1, so this factor will be neglected, so we are left out with 1 plus lambda VDS, and then I can replace this value with 1 plus lambda VDS. So that is placed here, that is 1 plus lambda VDS, and we got this complete expression ID set value. Okay, so this is the most generalized expression. Now in this expression, when there is no channel length modulation, when there is lambda is 0, then what will happen? This complete factor will change to unit 1, and my ID set will be equals to simple IDS value. And when there is a channel length modulation, you will get the current according to that. So this is the generalized expression which includes the modulation factor as well. Okay, so we got, this is the most generalized expression of the ID set under channel length modulation. Now what is the effect? So initially this ID set, initially this IDS was a function of half mu n C ox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square. There was no VDS term, so I said the current is constant. No VDS, this is VDS. There is no VDS, this means it is independent of VDS. But now in this expression, this ID is a linear function of VDS with some constant value. So since it is a function of VDS, so and that with a lambda which is less than 1, so there will be definitely some change in the value of the current, because VDS is finite and ID is finite. This means a finite value of some resistance will get, and due to presence of that resistance, there will be a non-zero slope, and we'll get a current of little high magnitude compared to the earlier position. Okay, so that way the channel length modulations, due to channel length modulation, there will be still some resistance offered. This means even in the saturation also, there will be some amount of finite resistance present in the device. We cannot say infinite, and that's why I can say that MOSFET is not an ideal current source. Ideal current source, it is not an ideal current source. Ideal current source means resistance should be very high, open circuit, but resistance should be infinite. But here, since there is a modulation in the current, we will say a finite amount of resistance is there, so it is not an ideal but a practical current source. Then here in this graph, it is shown that if we increase the length, then what will happen? The modulation, we can reduce the magnitude of the modulation, because my ultimate goal, whenever we design the circuit and when we are operating in saturation, we try to get the constant current. So our target is always to get a constant current. So that time we try to work on large size transistors where dimension, the length is large. If the length is large, what will happen? A small amount of modulation in the current we will see here. And as I said earlier also, in digital, this does not affect much the performance as compared to analog, because suppose if any analog system is there and it is saying that copy the current, means same current I want to regenerate two times. So let's say current ID1 is generated. I said that no, I want the same transistor I have placed here with the same dimension and everything is same, and ID2 is generated. So ideally ID1 should be equals to ID2. But since we are working with the short channel devices, short channel means where the channel length modulation is there, so what will happen? ID1 will get a lambda factor, and which will depend upon its own VDS. It will also have a lambda factor, but it will depend upon its own VDS voltage. So what will happen? We'll get this lambda VDS 1 minus lambda VDS 2 value. So when we do, when we want to see whether any difference is there, a finite amount of current will be there. So this is nothing but the error, lambda into delta V. Why this error is coming? Because of presence of lambda. Suppose if lambda is very less, means lambda is very, 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 very less than 1. So what will happen? This error value will tends to 0 and we will get a perfect matching of the current. So this is also in analog, a matching is very much important. So that's why it is, this channel modulation is the biggest drawback for the analog system designs. So this was your MOS IV characteristics. Now coming to the MOS CV characteristics. Now we know this is a MOSFET. Now this is your gate, drain, and this was your source. If I talk about NMOS, so this and this was N plus region, N plus, and this was your some metal layer. So what will happen, since there is a change in the charges, the capacitance will exist with each of the terminal. If suppose bulk is also there, also some capacitance will be existing. So what the MOS CV characteristics say, that each terminal of an MOS transistor, any PMOS or NMOS, will have a capacitance to the other terminal. Okay, and these capacitance are generally non-linear and voltage dependent. Depending upon the voltage, the values of this will be changed, because these are the parasitics, and these parasitics are functions of terminal voltages. So that's why they are non-linear in nature, and they are also voltage dependent. But while doing the analysis, we have to take some constant value of capacitor, then only we can do analysis. So we do some approximations, and when we do approximations, we approximate them as a simple capacitor, and then according to the switching voltage, whether it is in the cutoff region, whether it is in the linear region, or whether it is in the saturation region, based on all this, we decide that how much capacitance is offered in what region, and then according to the amount of capacitance or the region of operation, we estimate that what will be the delay when it is in the linear, or what will be the delay when it is in the cutoff mode or saturation. So their behavior is averaged by the across the switching voltages of a logic gate. So this is the, this capacitance are also called intrinsic capacitance, or you can also call it as a parasitic capacitances. So this was your NMOS, this is a p-type layer, this is N plus region. So what will happen, these are the capacitance which you will see. Number one capacitance is C1 is at this position. So this is between the gate and the channel. Okay, this is the channel. So C1 is called the gate to channel capacitance. Okay, second is C2, if you see, it is between the channel or the depletion region, and the, this is called your substrate. This substrate is also known as bulk. Okay, you may be see it is also said as a bulk. So C2 is a channel to bulk depletion capacitance. Okay, channel to bulk, in between this is depletion layer, so depletion capacitance between the channel to bulk, a bulk can be also sold as a substrate capacitance. So third is your C3 and C4. So where is C3? C3 is to the end of drain and source. So if this is drain, this is source. So what is this? This capacitance are formed due to the overlapping. Overlapping means when it was very difficult to make the aligned position of the gate with the drain and source, then we do some overlapping with LD or delta LD. So due to this, there is a capacitance form that is named as C3 and C4. So C3 and C4 are known as overlap gate source, either gate to source or gate to drain. Two sides are there, so two capacitance. It can be said as gate to source or gate to drain capacitance. And number five is your between drain and source to the bulk, that is C5 and C6 is your drain bulk junction capacitance, because this is a PN junction, a diode is there. So PN junction, so a drain bulk junction capacitance is there, that is bottom plate and side wall. So this will be at this place or this place, So that is a side wall. This is your side wall or a bottom plate capstans can be there. So this here it is shown in clearly. Okay, CJ or CJSW. CJSW means side wall and CJ stands for junction capstans. So this is your MOSFET. What are the possible? Now we are taking gate as a reference. So gate to drain is CGD. That is capstans due to gate to drain. If we take source, we will say gate to source a capacitance. If we take the third terminal, that is a bulk, that is nothing but your substrate, we will say gate to bulk. If we direct connect to here, if we connect from drain or source, we call it drain to bulk or source to bulk. So these are the possible capacitances that can be seen through the MOSFET. Apart from that, this only C3, C4 is overlap capstance is given by COX W into LD, because this C3 and C4 is the LD part, the overlapping path. So, and since this is a part of oxide capstance, and oxide is measured in per unit area. Okay, so we will multiply by W into L. So this area will cancel out and we'll get the capstance value. So CGS overlap is COX, part of COX into W into LD. Means only this much area is taken by the overlap. So we have multiplied. So we get the effective CGS value as a COX WLD. And similar is the case for the drain case. And what is COX? COX is nothing but the oxide capstance per unit area, that is epsilon OX by TOX. So the things to note is that both of these overlap capstans do not depend upon the bias condition. Rather, they are voltage independent because they are the overlap, and these two are not the function of biasing values. Means they will be always retained in the all of the mode, whether it is linear or saturation. Now here comes the reason by observation of the capacitance. So number one is cutoff mode. So in the cutoff mode, what happens? The surface is not inverted. Okay, no channel is there. So there is no conducting channel. So when there is no conducting channel, only the oxide capstances are there. So what will be the value of CGS and CGD? No values because there is no channel. And gate to bulk will be direct. The oxide capstance, only the oxide layer is there, dielectric. So gate to bulk is nothing but the oxide capstance. And how much to the total width and length complete MOSFET will offer, that will be the COX WL. So this is the total capstance seen in the cutoff mode. When the channel starts in the linear mode, when the gate voltage is sufficiently there such that the inversion occurred, and also there is a potential like VD is greater than 0 and VG also greater than 0, or you can say VG is greater than VTH. So there is a conducting inversion layer on the surface, which seals the substrate from the gate electric field. So what will happen? Gate to bulk, there is no direct connection of gate to bulk, but in between there is a channel. So that's why what will happen? Direct gate to bulk capstance will be zero. Rather, there will be gate to source and gate to drain capstance. And how much they will be? They will be nearly half of COX W by L. Okay, means equal distribution of capstance will be there till the pinch of point is reached. Means you can say here VDS is very very less and little bit high, means just to initiate the current. Okay, deep triode region you can say. So that time equal distribution of capacitance towards the drain and source end will be there. This complete capacitance is divided in equally between drain and source, and the value is half COX W into L. Then further VDS is increased, and then what happens? It moves towards the source end and a pinch of point occurs. So when the pinch of point occurs, what happens? And further VDS is increased, means the voltage is VD sat, means greater than VGS minus VTH. The pinch of point is moved, and due to which there is no connection, there is only depletion layer here. So what to drain and get to source. Okay, so gate to source will get the maximum capacitance, and that capacitance will be given by 2/3 of the complete capacitance, that is Cox W by L. So this is the rough estimates of the capacitance which will be seen according to the mode of operation. Okay, so suppose if we are working in linear region and if some resistance offered by MOSFET is said R on, so what will be the total delay? R on into whatever the capacitance is seen through the CGS value or CGD. So this is the table where all the capacitance are summarized. CGB, gate to bulk, CGD, gate to drain, CGS is gate to source. Now in the cutoff mode, there was no channel, the gate to bulk was complete device capacitance, that is Cox W by L. Once the channel is formed and VDS is little bit, means in the linear region, what will happen? There is no gate bulk, but this gate to drain will get the half of the value of Cox W by L. So it is half the value. Similarly, CGS will also get the half, sorry, here it is half the value, and CGS also gets the half the value. Apart from that, there was a capacitance, if you remember, the overlap capacitance, which was your voltage independent. It is just the overlap due to the device structure. So this will always exist. So due to this, in the linear mode, there will be Cox W by L present, and also in the CGS, additional of Cox W by L will be present. Once VDS is further very much high, means further it is increased, then what happens? The CGS, the CGD, this term will disappear and we are left with only overlap value. Whereas in the case of CGS, we get the twice third of the total capacitance plus the overlap. Okay, so from here, what we can conclude, that CGS is the most prominent factor, or CGS is playing the vital role when we are working in the saturation condition. Even in the linear also, there is equal amount of capacitance seen by the CGS if we compare with CGD. So whenever we do analysis, we take always in consideration the CGS capacitance, because it provides the maximum delay. It takes the maximum role in providing the delays. Now this is the curve, which is the normalized with Cox by W by L, means in different region. Suppose in the cutoff region, if Cox W by L, Cox W L is given by C, so that normalized value means take the division, this will get the value of 1. So in the cutoff mode, CGB gets the highest value, that is Cox W by L. Once we move to the saturation region, what happens? This value gets reduced by 2 by 3 value. So 2 by 3 value, and that will be dominated by CGS. Overlap is not shown here. Okay, CGS. And further, if we move to linear region, so this 2 by 3rd value, the Cox W by L value, get further reduced to half, and it reaches to half, which is in the linear region. Okay, in the saturation region, this is the curve. In the saturation region, what happened to the CGD? Both are zero here, CGS and CGD. In the saturation, the CGS dominates, where the CGD is only very small. Okay, CGD is only the overlap value. But when we move to linear, the CGD gets rise, and it becomes equal to CGS. Okay, so this is one plot, and this plot is against the VDS, means increasing the VDS, what happens? So when VDS is zero, means no VDS is there, no current flowing is there, so maximum capacitance is Cox, C naught is nothing but WLC of the total device capacitance. And once we increase the VDS, what happens? Suddenly, once we increase the VDS, the capacitance will start rising. If it is CGS, it will start rising from half Cox, this is nothing but half Cox WL. It starts rising, and whereas CGD reduces. Okay, because we are moving towards the saturation. So moving towards the saturation means CGD is reducing and CGS is increasing. Okay, now these were the parasitic capacitance across the terminals. Now there are some junction capacitance due to that sidewalls and bottom plate. So voltage dependent source substrate or drain substrate junctions offers the CSB and CDB capacitances. Okay, source to bulk and drain to bulk. Okay, like this is your drain terminal. Similarly here it is a source terminal. So this is N plus and this is P. So how many types of captions we can see? In all the directions we can see the captions to the total whatever the area is there. So it can be this side captions, or it can be this one, or in towards the this end. So these all are called your junction capacitances, and these all are given by Cj equals to, which is a function of V. Okay, this is given by A into Cj naught. This is called your zero bias junction capacitance. Okay, so zero bias junction capacitance means under no voltage what is the capacitance seen, and once the voltage is applied, definitely the capacitance value will change. So that is becomes the function of V. So, and where M is called your gradient coefficient. If it is a abrupt junction, then it is taken as half. If it is a linear graded junction, then it's taken as 1/3. And how this zero bias junction capacitance is given by? It is depending upon epsilon si, the permittivity of the silicon material, Na and the dopings, and the potential phi naught, which is given by this value. Okay. So this was your till capacitances. Now comes your problems. Okay, one problem we can discuss here. Time is there. So this is the problem of a threshold. So here it is said, this is the architecture given. Plot the drain current if Vx varies from minus infinity to zero. So this means Vx, where is Vx? This is Vx. This is varied from 0 to infinity. Okay. And then given is Vth naught, and gamma is given, and phi of our substrate is given. So we have to plot Id versus Vx graph. So we have to plot, this is Id and this is Vx, and we have to take minus infinity to 0. What happens in this condition? Since here phi f is negative, or even in the architecture, if you see, the arrow symbol is given at the in the outward direction. This means which is your source terminal? This is your source terminal where arrow is here. This is your drain terminal, and this one is your gate terminal. Which type of MOS it is? If you look in the symbol, the arrow is going outward. This means it is a NMOS. Other thing you can see, Vth is plus here. This means again it is saying it is NMOS. Phi f is negative here, this is NMOS. Okay, gamma is positive here. So if you recall, this is the slide taken from the previous lecture. Here the Fermi potential phi f will be negative for NMOS, positive for the PMOS. Then this is the charge density. Here that information is not given. Gamma is given, it is positive for NMOS and negative for PMOS. Okay, so from this we can deduce that this is a NMOS architecture. Okay, so once we have identified this is NMOS architecture, now we'll go for the plot. So what the question is saying, that plot Vx, plot Id versus Vx. Okay, so now if you see, Vx is attached to the fourth terminal, that is the bulk terminal. Once it is attached to the bulk terminal, definitely there will be some threshold voltage modulation. So we will recall the body effect, or the set threshold voltage expression. That threshold voltage expression is given by Vt naught plus gamma square root of minus 2 phi f plus Vsb and 2 phi f. So now you substitute the value. So how we'll proceed? Now here the voltage Vt naught is given 0.3, gamma is given, 2 phi f is given, so minus 2 phi f will become plus 0.7 plus Vsb. What is Vsb voltage here? Vsb is equals to Vs minus Vb. What is Vs here? Vs is 0 because this is your source. So source is grounded, so Vs is 0. Vb is Vx, so it is minus Vx. So it is minus Vx. Let's say at Vx1 we are calculating, and 2 phi is 0.7. Now in order to get the graph, how Vx varies changes the Id current. So when we look for the Id current, we get the value of half mu naught Cx W by Vgs minus, this is your Vt voltage. Fine. So what should be Vt? So here if we see, gate voltage is 1.2. Now when Vx is increased, or Vx is decreased, what does happen? So in this expression, if my Vsb is positive, so what will happen? My threshold voltage will increase or decrease? It will decrease. Okay, the positive quantity Vsb is positive, it is further increasing. So what will happen? This factor will become positive. Okay, so my Vt will decrease, so my Id will increase. So here in this question, my Vsb, I have to take, let's say it is Vsb is 0. So what will happen when Vsb is 0? This complete will be cancelled out and we'll get Vt equals to Vt naught. This means when Vsb is 0, my Vt will be equals to Vt naught. There will be no change in the threshold voltage. So in the graph, when Vx is 0, my Id will be equals to, at this, when Vx is 0, my Id will be equals to half mu n Cox W by L Vgs minus Vt naught whole square, and that will give me some fixed value. So let's say it is some here x value. Fine. Now what happens if we reduce Vsb? So if Vsb is reduced, so what happened? Overall, this factor will be dominating to this factor. So what will happen? We'll get some positive value. Some positive value means my Vt will increase. So once my Vt is increasing, what happens in the expression? If my Vt is increasing, this is variable now, and if it is increasing, what will happen? My effective current will start reducing. So it will reduce. So from here, if we Vx, if I take negative, the current will start reducing. Okay, and it will reduce to what value? It will reduce to the value till it reaches the maximum. So somewhat graph should come like this. Now here, how the prediction is made, that at what point it should cut? So what is the point here where it should go to the zero? So in order to predict that one, given is 1.2 VGS. Here what is VGS value is 1.2. Now we know that any MOSFET is on when my VGS is greater than or equal to VTH. So this means here VGS, the worst condition, that VGS must be equals to VTH, minimum it should be that one, and according to a given question, VGS is 1 to 1.2 volt, and when it can be reached 1.2 volt, this means VTH is increasing when there is some modulation at the bulk. Fine. So that 1.2 is substituted here, and then let's say at VX1 we are getting this 1.2 volt. So from this, we have computed at Vx is minus 8.83. So at this point, I will get Vth equals to 1.2. So this is the graph. So this value will be minus 8.83 volt. Okay. And when Vx is 0, we get some certain value of Ix, that is simple Ids expression here. So this is the graph of the threshold. So now here the questions can be framed like, at what value of body voltage or at what value of Vx the threshold voltage of the MOSFET will become equal to, or what is the minimum, what is the worst case of Vx such that the threshold voltage can be reached to the maximum value? So it is 1. So it is, by using this concept, we can calculate the value of Vx. Okay, or at what Vx value the threshold voltage will reach 1.2 volt. So using this relation, you can calculate the Vx value, the body voltage. Okay. And if you see here, if Vx becomes negative, Vts decreases. So whether this is correct or not, we have to check. Suppose if the question is, check whether if Vsb becomes negative, Vts will decrease or not. So if Vsb is negative, if this changes is negative value, so what will happen? Threshold voltage minus minus, this complete will become, this factor will become greater here. So what will happen? My threshold voltage will increase or decrease. It will become positive. So is this correct? If Vsb negative, then minus minus plus. So it increases, right? I hope it was decreasing. So minus minus will become plus. Okay, so this is not correct then. And then is there any channel length modulation in the triode region? What should be the answer for this one? Whether any channel length modulation should be there in the triode region? Can anybody answer for this one? Channel length modulation, when it occurs when my VDS is greater than VGS minus VTH. So whether any channel length modulation will be there in the triode region? This is nothing but the saturation. So it is not possible because it happens only after the pinch off condition. Okay, channel length modulation, when it takes place, this is the pinch off, and when it takes place, then this pinch off point reaches to this place. Okay, then we say channel length modulation is occurring. So it is not possible in the triode region. Okay. So next is IV problem that we'll see in the next class.